Hello and welcome to our Sunday evening worship service as we once again gather to worship and glorify our Father in heaven. May all praise, honor, and glory be unto Him. In the name of Jesus, our Lord and Savior, we hope you will be both enlightened and edified by today's lesson. Thank you for joining us.
Well, good evening, everyone. Welcome back this evening. If we have any visitors, we want to welcome you. Glad you're here with us this evening. Let us have a word of prayer as we begin. Dear Heavenly Father, we're grateful to have this opportunity to rejoin and gather before you again this evening. We're thankful for this morning's lesson, Bible class, and the lesson during the sermon, and we just look forward to tonight's as well. Help us to continue to grow spiritually from your word, go out into the world, very troubling world, and bring your message out to others, and hopefully bring others closer to you. We just ask that you watch over us, guide us, protect us, forgive us when we fail you. But all these things we ask, in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Our first song this evening will be number 320, number 320. After this song, we'll be led in.
Let's go to God in prayer at this time. Heavenly Father, we're so thankful to you that we have this privilege that we can approach your majestic throne at this hour. Father, we praise you for your wisdom of the church, for we realize that we are alone or weak, but with one another, we are strong. Thank you for this privilege of assembly where we can come together, where we can be with one another, that we can praise your name, sing songs of praise unto you, and worship you, our God, who we glorify. Thank you, Father, for Jesus Christ, the light of the world, whom our lives revolve around. Father, we ask that you forgive us for everything that we have said, done, or thought that was not pleasing to you. And keep us safe from the evils in this world. And help us to glorify you with that each and every day. Help us to make the best of each day. And to help clear our minds of wrong things. And use us to do your will on this earth. Bless us that we may be a blessing to others. For we never know who we might run into that needs to hear the gospel. Father, we pray for those that are weak. We pray for those that are spiritually lost, those that are misunderstood, and those that do not know your love and your saving grace. Father, be with those that are unable to be here. All those around the world that are unable to come to worship service because of sickness. We ask that you be with them, that if it's your will, you heal them and they can once again meet with their family of Christ, knowing how important the church is. Father, thank you for our daily lives, which we live in. Be with us when troubles abound, that we can turn to you in times of trouble, knowing you, the great God, will take care of all things. And Father, we ask that you be with the Bible class teachers that spend a lot of their time teaching our youngsters. Be with our young people, and even be with the older people that make up your church, because the church is so important. And Father, our goal is that one day we'll see glory. We'll see your shining face. And hopefully we have to hear the words, "Well done, thy good and faithful servant." This is our prayer in Jesus Christ's blessed name. Amen.
Number 438, 438.
My hope is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness. I dare not trust the sweetest frame, but wholly lean on Jesus' name. On Christ the solid rock I stand, all other ground is sinking sand. All other ground is sinking sand. Darkness fails his lovely face, I rest on his unchanging grace. In every high and stormy gale, my anchor holds within the veil. On Christ the solid sound. Oh, may I be in him.
If you'd like to mark our invitation song, it would be number 768, number 768. And the song before Brother Mitchell's lesson will be number 773, 773.
Good to see each of you this evening. It's always a pleasure, always a blessing to be able to come together with people who share the same faith posture and are committed to the text of scriptures that stands. We've been speaking about over the past few weeks, the various elements of the fruit of the Spirit. And I want us to come tonight to look together at faithfulness. We've studied love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness. And you may be thinking, well, I'm not sure that I can take anymore because I haven't mastered patience yet. Well, welcome to my world. But do not despair. Remember, you are growing spiritual fruit. It's a set. It comes as a set. And all nine qualities that are listed by Paul are part of one whole. They're interrelated, and they grow together. Faithfulness is a word we don't hear a lot today, in most public circles anyway. And it's usually reserved for retirement parties. After 30 or more years of faithful service, a teacher gets, I think in Livingston, get a rocking chair, I believe is what they get. And so that's the mention or the notice it's given to faithful service. When most think of the word faithful, we think of old things. You know, my dog may be old and ugly, but he sure is faithful. Or my car may be old, ugly, and bent up, but it sure is faithful. To be faithful means to be reliable, to be worthy of trust or trustworthy, to be dependable, to be consistent. And faithfulness is, unfortunately, a much more rare commodity than it ought to be. In Proverbs chapter 20 and verse 6, the wise man said, who can find a faithful man? So this is not a new problem. The scarcity is not new. It's not easy to find someone who can really be counted on and really be trusted to be there to come through when things are tough. As a preacher, I've learned that not nearly everybody who volunteers comes through. You know, there's people that will volunteer to, you know, move them out. But now, you better wait to see the first spadeful of dirt and rocks be moved before you get too excited. We should be faithful. We ought to be faithful, all of us, because God's faithful. It's a characteristic of deity. In Psalm 33 at verse 4, the text says, the word of the Lord is upright, and all his work is done in faithfulness. Since God desires us to be like him, he wants us to learn to be faithful in our lives. Moreover, faithfulness makes life easier, makes it more pleasant. Unfaithfulness is the cause of so many, many difficult problems. Proverbs chapter 25 and verse 19 said, like a bad tooth and an unsteady foot is confidence in a faithless man in time of trouble. You ever had a bad toothache? Everybody here who's had a toothache knows what we're talking about. Or a sore foot? If you got a sore foot, you're diminished all over. I mean, you know, you're not going far with a bad foot. And so you know what it's like to have a blister on your foot. It hurts, burns, stings. You know what it's like to have a throbbing tooth that just, you know, you're about ready to pull it out yourself before you can get down to the dentist. In the back of your mind, you're always wondering, will this person let me down again? Or will I come through at this time? They're just a faithless man. Solomon says he's like a bad tooth or sore foot. And working with inconsistent people, unreliable people, makes for frustration in the extreme. I worked one summer, had the good fortune to get hired on with a clothing manufacturer for children called Garin Incorporated. And they were good folks to work for. But you would be late without a pretty good excuse one time, and one time only. Because they wanted you there on time, they wanted you online, or you better have a good reason not to. Your job wrote on that. They required it. And it was good that they required it. We all look for faithfulness in others so that we can go about our daily tasks. We want items delivered at the proper time. We want them actually delivered. We want the mail carrier to be faithful, not have a habit of running over our mailbox, and delivering the mail that we post. I want the food at the favored restaurant or the favored place that I secure groceries. I want that to be consistent from week to week to week. And so the most famous geyser in North America is called Old Faithful. It is not the best known. I should say it is the best known, but it's not the most powerful, and not at all. But what makes it so popular with the people? Because you can set a clock by it. It's reliable. It's dependable. It runs like a dependable clock. People appreciate dependability, even in geysers. Do you have a reputation? We all ought to ask ourselves, is my reputation one of reliability? Can other people count on me to be where I said I was going to be and do what I said I was going to do? You can be talented and you can be educated. You can be creative. But if you're not dependable, all those great gifts that God has given to you are not going to be of much value. Someone said the greatest ability is dependability. And I'm not sure that that didn't rhyme. Another reason to be faithful is that God rewards faithfulness. You look at the parable of the talents in Matthew chapter 25. Jesus says, one day God's going to judge us based on our faithfulness. That's what that passage teaches. The judgment will be not to evaluate our ability or our good intention. God will judge us and reward us according to our faithfulness. The man with two talents, doubled his talents. He was not expected to do what the five-talent man did. God didn't require that of him. And the man with the one talent was condemned, not because he was the least talented, because he didn't do anything. He didn't accomplish anything. He didn't put to use the resources God put in his hands. The Bible says a faithful person will be richly blessed. So if you want to be rewarded in heaven, and I don't know anybody that doesn't, then we all have to learn to be dependable person. Notice things that can be done to develop that habit, that way of life called faithfulness. Number one, keep your promises. Keep your promises. Honor your promises. Honor your commitments. Proverbs 25:14, like clouds and wind without rain is a man who boasts of his gifts falsely. Honor your promises. Do you know people like this cloud that make promises, and those promises never seem to come true? They don't keep them. They may declare, I'm planning to do it, but they don't ever get around to doing it. I remember Brother Dooley used to carry a little wooden doubloon-looking thing, and it said, round to it, on there. And somebody started that, almost, and I never have got around to it. You know, Brother Andy said, well, I want you to take this round to it. And, he was a mess. What a good one. I think about him all the time. Be careful about the promises you make. Have you ever told somebody you'll call them back later and forgot all about it? Probably everybody's done that one time or another, but it sure doesn't need to be habitual. Have you ever said the check's in the mail before it was in the mail? I don't know. Have you promised to pray for somebody and forgotten to? You need, all of us need, especially, I include myself in everything I preach, we need to be dependable. When we say, I will return it soon, or we'll do it later, or whatever we say, let us be in the habit of keeping our word. Let it be said about our people all over this community. I'll tell you one thing, those people do what they say. You know, sometimes a parent, in a moment of weakness, will make promises to children to get them out of their hair. You know, just get them to go on, leave you alone for a few minutes. And they promise something that doesn't even register in their mind. And weeks later, they may not even remember it, but that child remembers it. With children, don't forget anything, ever. No, ever. You have to keep your promises. Proverbs chapter 20 and verse 25 says, it is a snare for a man to say rashly, it is holy, and after the vows, make inquiry. In other words, it's always easier to get in than to get out. Do you know the number one problem in parent-child relationships? The number one problem is said to be the people they're supposed to know more than we do is resentment. It might not be number one, but it's certainly one of the big ones. And the number one cause of resentment is, as the child sees it, broken promises. Ecclesiastes chapter 5 and verse 5, the preacher says, it is better that you should not vow than that you should vow and not pay. You know, banks really don't, a lot of folks don't seem to know, they don't keep all the money there, and it's not their money. What they do is collect our money, and then they loan that out, our money, they loan it out, and then they collect it, and they keep up with it, and for that service, they charge a fee. That's how they make their money. But they're not the owner of it. And so it's better that you should not vow, and you should vow not, or you that you should vow not pay. Because if you don't pay the bank when you've made a vow, what's going to happen? What's going to happen to that pickup truck? It's going to be sitting right down there on the street here downtown. And I remember Brother Townley one time and I were talking. He said, and we don't want the truck. We don't want the car. We don't want any of that stuff. We want people to be successful and pay what they have vowed to pay. And so we need to be a people that will fulfill our vows. What have you promised your wife? What have you promised your husband if you're a wife? What have you promised the children, the brethren, and the Lord? Do you intend to keep it? Are you scrupulous about keeping it? When you are dependable, you don't have to convince people that you're dependable. You don't have to make a big deal out of it. You don't have to say things like, cross my heart, hope to die, and stick a needle in my eye. It isn't necessary to say, I ain't lying, I swear. You know, I've learned over the years when somebody says that, that rascal's lying. I don't even want to hear it. And so it isn't necessary to say those things if you have dependability, if you're known for dependability, if you exhibit dependability. No, you simply say you'll do it and then proceed to do it. Matthew chapter 5 and verse 37 said, but let your statement be yes, yes, or no, no, and anything beyond these is evil. Just state the truth and let that be it. Over time, your record will speak for itself. Others will feel confident that they can count on you. Why? Because they can count on you. God will be also taking note of what happens, as he always is in heaven. Number two, honor your marriage covenant. If you want to develop faithfulness and reliability, then you certainly want to honor the covenant of marriage. In a wedding ceremony, the bride and the groom, if I do it, exchange rings after having made vows to one another, and they exchange rings as a symbol and a reminder of the vows that have been uttered. And they promise to be faithful to each other for the rest of their lives. Because, you know, again, if I'm saying it, I'm going to ask them to do it. And adultery is not the only way to become unfaithful to your vow. All one has to do is allow something else, for example, to take priority over the covenant of marriage. What do you mean? Well, activities that are not bad in and of themselves, but things like sports, a community involvement, you know, the Democrat club, the Republican club, and whatever other kind of club there is that are politically oriented, hunting, fishing, TV, work, a lot of things like that, you can elevate to a position to where you've been unfaithful to your vow to your spouse because you're consumed with things like that. So say, not bad in and of themselves, but when they get out of balance, it can become bad. The Bible says, if you are married, your relationship to your mate is second only to your relationship to God. In Hebrews chapter 13 and verse 4, the Hebrews writer tells us, let marriage be held in honor among all, and let the marriage bed be undefiled, for fornicators and adulterers God will judge. So underline that word, honored. The word means to hold in respect, to value with high esteem, to take seriously. If you want to develop the quality of faithfulness, honor your marriage vow. Put effort into it. The love chapter in 1 Corinthians 13, Paul didn't say that, but we've appended that to it because it discusses, of all things, love. And 1 Corinthians 13 says, when you love someone, that person can count on you. They can rely on you. Conversely, when you're unreliable, you're not being very loving. Faithfulness is a choice. It's not dependent on what others do. Like we said this morning, love is not uncontrollable and undirectable. You make a commitment, and regardless of what your mate does, you choose to be faithful to the vows that you made before God and before the community. Keep your promises. Honor your marriage. That's a route to faithfulness. Number three, use your talents. God gave everybody in this house talents and gifts, physical, mental, spiritual. And in giving those things, he made an investment in each one of us. And he wants each of us, expects each of us, to produce a return on his investment. In 1 Peter chapter 4 and verse 10, as each one has received a gift, administer it to one another as good stewards of the manifold grace of God. If you do not use the talents that God gives, others will be cheated because you're not contributing what God equipped you to provide. You know, when there's something that needs doing, and we survey among the congregation, if all of us are not willing to use the talents God gave us, then we're not making the contribution that he needs us to make to his church in that circumstance. Now, you might say, well, I'm not talented like her. I'm not talented like him. I can't sing like that lady does. Well, neither can I. I can't sing like brethren do, much less one of the ladies. I can't do that. But Jesus, because I can't do something spectacular, I'm not excused from doing what I can do. I remember we had an elder at Adamsville, Tennessee, Brother James Wood, fine, godly man. But James talked like that. And so he said, you know, the Lord said sing, so I sing, but I try not to sing loud enough to disturb everybody else's worship, you know, because he just didn't have a singing voice. But he was a fine man, a good elder. Faithfulness depends on what I do with what I have. I'm not responsible to be a virtuoso because I'm not one. But I am responsible to use the gifts and talents that God gave me. We cannot all be brilliant. We cannot all be all things, you know, that great athlete or whatever. But we can all be faithful. And faithfulness is what counts with the Lord. So keep your promises. Honor your covenant of marriage. Use your talents. Then make good use of your time. Time is a precious commodity. I'm not sure how to define it. I've always been uncomfortable with the concept, but I can't deny it. That there is going from here to there, and I perceive it as being a linear thing, but we get off into some philosophical language. But the point is, we need to make good use of the time that we're here. Time is something all of us have in common. Everybody that is alive, as long as they stay alive, has 168 hours per week. In Ephesians 5, verses 15 and 16, Brother Paul says, therefore, be careful how you walk, not as unwise men, but as wise, making the most of your time, because the days are evil. I've learned, and you have too, a long time ago, that this wonderful, mysterious gift we call life is fleeting, and you never, ever know. That's why I always urge people, love your people while you have them. Don't leave home with unresolved conflict and angry with one another. Don't do that. Love them while you have them. And be thankful for the fact that you do have them. We want to make good use of our time. You can do three things with time. You can spend time, you can waste time, or you can invest time. And the best use of time is to invest it in something that will outlast you. To invest it in something that will be of benefit to the cause of the Lord. Faithfulness involves, among other things, time management. And there are two time wasters that are among the worst. One is regret, and the other one's worry. When we regret the past, we waste huge chunks of time looking back, longing to change something that you can't change. You can't unsay what's been said. You can't do it. I wish I could unsay some things that I've said in my lifetime. You can't undo what's been done. And so to spend a lot of time back there doesn't resolve anything. It doesn't make whatever the problem was any better. And so we don't want to get involved in that. We don't want to waste the time that we have thinking about what might have been. When we worry about the future, we waste time fretting over events that may never occur. You know, I have to admit some of the melancholy of the Celt people, and I call it not worry but running contingencies. But sometimes it steps over into worry. Well, you can't, why worry about something that may not come? Well, you know, they said that last hurricane that came through here was going to hit Mexico. And the Mexican people, I don't know whether they worried about it or not, but if they did, they didn't need to. Why? Because it hit Texas. Nobody knows where a hurricane's going to go until it makes landfall. I've been in too many of them. And so why just work? Just do what you can to prepare and move on down the road. You can spend time. You can get involved in wasting time, and regret and worry are two of the primary things that people do that just waste that time. And as a result of worrying and fretting over things that may not ever occur, we waste time and energy allotted for today. Now, there's always plenty to do in a day. I can find a lot myself, and my wife can find more than I can. I mean, there's just always things that need doing. And so to become more faithful, you have to give up the when and the then thinking. When the children finish school, then we'll do whatever that was. When and then thinking is not profitable. The Lord said, be faithful now. Be faithful right now. You know, when I get my life straightened out, then I'll be faithful. And not thinking like that, you won't. Let me offer a guilt-relieving statement, I hope. God understands your schedule. He understands that people are pulled in every direction. He really does. And he understands it better than all of us do. So what should we do? Talk with him about it. And when you burn the candle at both ends, someone has said, you're not near as bright as you may think. So you probably need to eliminate some things if you're burning the candle at both ends. And you may need to add some other things. Time with the Lord in prayer, time in the Word of God, will direct these choices. Spend time there. Number five, stand by your friends. Friends are priceless commodities. Stand by your friend. When my and Pamela's grandson was killed, I looked around and there was Hiawatha Jones and several of you. I won't name every several of you. Didn't expect it. Had no way to, and wouldn't have required it, but people came. That meant a lot, just seeing them, just seeing those faces. Stand by your friends. Another way to develop faithfulness is to cultivate personal loyalty. A faithful person stands by his friends, Proverbs 17 and 17. A friend loves at all times, and a brother is born for adversity. Genuine friends are reliable. They are consistent. They are precious. They can be counted on in a crisis. And someone has said, when times get tough, a true friend doesn't see through you, but they see you through. In whom, or in to whom, are you loyal? Who can count on you? Do they know they can count on you? So we all want to be that reliable person that folks know that they can count on. If I ask you to write letters to five people that you knew you could count on, to whom would you write? Or flip it. If somebody was writing five people they could depend on, how many of them would include your name? Stand by your friend. Then there is the need to manage your money. We're talking about developing faithfulness, consistency, reliability. dependability. It's all those things. If you want to develop the spiritual fruit of faithfulness, you've got to learn to manage your money, your resources. God gave us resources, and how you handle money is a test of our faithfulness to Him. In Luke 16 and verse 11, the text says, "If then you have not been faithful in unrighteous wealth," talk about physical wealth, "who will entrust you with true riches?" That's a pretty good question. In fact, it answers itself, doesn't it? It's rhetorical. Nobody. Amazing. God says, if you are not faithful with your material possessions, He will not entrust you with spiritual resources. He's not going to take the chance. And so that's an important matter, highly important matter. You must ask yourself, am I faithful in giving back to the Lord? Do I pay my bills on time? And I need to compare my giving with my spending and compare my spending with my saving and to see how things are in balance. Am I being a wise manager of the money God put at my disposal? You know, there are people that I've known. I have a little cousin that married a young man who was a young widower, and they've done very well together. He's a faithful Christian man, but everything that guy's ever touched turned to gold. He is a good manager with the things that God put at his disposal, and he's done good with a lot of what God's put at his disposal. The way you handle your finances determines to a large extent what God will be willing to do with and in your life. What does it mean to be faithful with your finances? Well, specifically, what does it mean? What does it mean to be, for example, faithful in giving? 1 Corinthians chapter 16 and verse 2 gives the answer. On the first day of every week, let each one of you lay aside or lay by in store as he may prosper. Let there be no collections when I come. And so this verse defines three elements of faithful giving. It must be regular, not just a every once in a while thing, but it must be practiced regularly. It is to be weekly. It is to be every Sunday. A faithful person's giving is to be systematic, not spasmodic. Some think that the most spiritual giving occurs when a person impulsively, motivated by emotion, gives a big gift. Not so. Not so. God said giving must be consistent each Lord's day, whether we feel like it or not. I told the students about something I read about Brother David Lipscomb. He says a young man, he had some problem with covetousness. And so he would purpose in his heart what he's going to give, and the devil, you know, that little voice in the ear would say, "No, you don't want to do that. You don't want to do that. That's too much." He says, what I decided to do in the battle with the adversary was just double it every time he tempted me that way. He said, it wasn't long that I didn't get tempted that way anymore. That was brilliant. Giving is to be planned. The Christian must prayerfully plan and set aside something from what has been earned. And if you're married, you should discuss that with your spouse, with your mate. If you do not plan, you won't give consistently. Remember, God is looking for faithfulness. He didn't tell us we had to be perfect. In fact, He told us we wouldn't be perfect. We couldn't be perfect. But He did say, you got to be faithful. Faithful giving is important, or He wouldn't have addressed it as much as He did. It is a percentage of income. And the amount given should depend on how much the Lord helped you earn. He doesn't expect me to give what Bill Gates could give, or Warren Buffett or somebody like that. He doesn't require that of me. He just requires me to do the best I can with what I have at my disposal. Do your best at work if you're going to be a faithful person. You want to develop that? Do your best. If you're responsible for hiring at work, if you were the personnel director, what would you look for? I imagine dependability to be at the top of the list, because you don't want to have to start off a job and half the crew's not there. Where are they? Well, I don't know. They're laid up in bed, I guess. You know, I filled out a number of reference forms, written a number of letters of recommendation for people. And I can tell you that personnel directors, principals, what have you, police chiefs, and on and on. They'll mention things like dependability, trustworthiness, punctuality, reliability, consistency. They want to know if you'll share with them your perception of how that person is. Employers, universities, colleges, government agencies of all kinds want to know about a person's faithfulness in their work habits. How can you work, affect your faithfulness? Luke 16 and verse 19 says, "He who is faithful in very little thing is faithful also in much. He who is unrighteous in a very little thing is unrighteous also in much." Life consists largely, brethren, of little things. Little things. And if you're not faithful in the little things, you're not faithful with most of your life, because that's where most of life is. Same is true with spiritual growth. The little things like daily prayer, systematic Bible study, those things produce big, big results. And success comes from being faithful in little things that other people may overlook. How do you handle little things? Faithfulness is also affected by we handle what is not ours. Luke 16 and verse 12. "And if you have not been faithful in the use of that which is another's, who will give you that which is your own?" Now, my neighbor during the recent hurricane, he's a locksmith, and we needed somebody to get in there and plug our freezer into the generator. Well, we ended up taking a picture of our key. He made a key. And he got in there and he did that for us. And then he put all the stuff back up after the power came back on. But you know where we found that key? We found it hanging on a little thing that we have in our kitchen. Because I told him, I said, "Keep it, because I might need you again." He didn't do it. He left it hanging there. He is a reliable, faithful man. I've had that experience with him. How do you handle little things? Most of life is little stuff. So if you're not faithful with that, you're not faithful with most of life. You know, when at work, am I trustworthy with the supplies as if I'd paid for them? There are people who hit that supply cabinet and break a business if you don't watch them, because they'll waste stuff. Would I buy a rental car that I just turned in after a week of abuse? Would I want to buy it? How do you handle the things that are not yours? God says that is the test of faithfulness. Faithfulness is important in many areas of life. And so that's why the Bible promises you will be rewarded for your faithfulness. Paul said in Colossians 3 and verse 23, "Whatever you do, do your work heartily as for the Lord rather than for men." Christians should have a reputation for being the most dependable people at work. Commit to the Lord's church. You want to be a faithful person. Commit to the Lord's church. Paul writes in Romans 12 and verse 5, "So we who are many are one body in Christ and individually members of one another." We're one people, one family. Each Christian belongs to all the other members of the body. This is why the local church is so essential. People treat it as if it's, do it or not do it, whatever pleases you, and that is the wrong thinking. Christians are engaged in a spiritual battle. Read Ephesians chapter 6, verses 10 through 18. Read it on a regular basis. Paul tells people that we are involved in a real fight, much more serious than the carnal wars that rage as bad as they are. And the Bible describes the Christian life with a number of military-type terms. War words, fight, conquer, strive, battle, overcome, victory. Christians are likened to soldiers in 2 Timothy 2 and verse 3. Paul tells us to put on the full armor of God in Ephesians 6, verse 11. Don't leave anything out. Because if you don't, the adversary will attack you at that spot. You are in a spiritual body battle, and within the spiritual body, whether you know it or not. And you need support and you need reinforcement. And when you became a Christian, you signed up to be a part of God's army. You know, there was a good bit of racial stress in the military in some parts of Vietnam. My dad had heard some of that on the news, and my brother was there. So he talked to him about that when he got home, and he said, "Dad, up where I am, the only thing anybody cares about is that guy wearing the same uniform you're wearing. And will he stand his ground? That's all. That's all that matters." So they didn't have their problems that some others had. When you became a Christian, you signed up to be part of God's army. When you became a Christian, you committed to Christ. And so now you can become part of the local body by committing yourself to the local body, to the brethren. That's what church membership is, a commitment to other Christians. It is a decision to become a participant, not merely a spectator. You stop being a consumer and become a contributor. Who can count on you? Can anyone? There is no such thing as the Lone Ranger Christian. The word in the original language, koinonia, translated fellowship, means being as committed to each other as we are to our Lord. Jesus said, "By this all men will know that you are my disciples, if you have love one for another." John 13 and verse 35. Love expresses itself in faithfulness to others. Are you here ready to express that love to the Lord? Won't you come to the source of grace and mercy? Won't you come on His terms without reservation? Give it all up. Give it to Him. If you believe, repent, and turn from sin, confess His name, then be buried with Him in baptism, then walk in newness of life, allowing Him to direct. Be faithful and be reliable. We can help you. Won't you come as together we stand and sing?
Be seated, please. This time we'll sing number 742 to help to prepare our minds for the Lord's Supper, number 742.
Take this time to give those people the opportunity to take the Lord's Supper. Didn't have the opportunity this morning. Let's go to our Heavenly Father in prayer and pray about the emblems we're about to take. Dear Heavenly Father, we're thankful for the emblem of the unleavened bread that you have given to us to partake in remembrance of your body. We pray that the ones can take this in a manner well-pleasing to you, in a way that will be strengthening to them also spiritually. In Christ's name, amen. Let us pray again. Dear Heavenly Father, again, as we think about the fruit of the vine, we take it in remembrance of the blood that was shed on the cross, the blood that cleanses us from all unrighteousness. Pray that, again, that these individuals can partake in a manner, be pleasing to you. In Christ's name, amen. Another act of worship that we are able to be involved in is the act of giving back as we prospered. Again, let us go to our Heavenly Father in prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, we're thankful for the many blessings that you give to us, blessings that sometimes we take for granted, but help us to show our love back to you by giving back in a way that would be pleasing to you. In Christ's name, amen.
I want to continue to remind you that our sister Jo Helen is going to be beginning her treatments here pretty quick. She defeated cancer 19 years ago, and we hope and pray and are confident that she'll do that again. She's like some other people, kind of like Hiawatha. She's a private person, and she'll tell you what she wants us to know when she wants us to know it. We can always be praying as this process works out, and pray for the doctors, pray for her. Also, I think about Brother Darrell Laird. Now, he's been having just fits with his neck and some other injuries he's had. You know, we pay for things when we get a little bit older than we did when we were younger and thought we were invincible. But that didn't make it any less. And once you continue to pray for Darrell, that he'll get some resolution and relief. He doesn't spend a lot of time complaining, but I know that he's done a lot of suffering. It is my understanding that after today, Sister Evelyn Kirkpatrick will be living out at the Tall Pines. She told me her room was number 8. And so if you're out by the Tall Pines, and in fact, if you're not out by there, just make a point to be out by there sometime and go in there and see Evelyn at room 8. She'll probably be down in the recreation area playing dominoes or something for blood. And so we want to try to make sure that she knows that she's always going to be a part of us. Let's be standing as we're dismissed with a prayer.
Would you pray with me? Dear Heavenly Father, thank you for allowing us to wake up this morning and to worship you, Father. And Father, we want to thank you for the many blessings that you have given us. Father, we want to thank you for bringing back up Brother Lindell safe from his trip to Guatemala. Father, we pray for those who are ill so that you may touch them with your healing hand, Father, so that they may get a lot better. Father, we want to pray for the Church of Christ around the world so that as one, we may grow and continue leading others towards you, Father. Father, as we go throughout our week, help us lead others towards you. And Father, help us go through our week with many obstacles that, Father, we need your help. We need you because out in this world, it's not nice. And you are the only one who is truly our only friend. Father, please help those who are on the prayer list that I may not know at this time, but you know who they are. In Christ's name we pray, amen.